Notion. You want to learn more about it? I can help you with that, because today I'm going to go through most of the features you can find in Notion and how I've used them to organize myself, trying to be more productive. Like the plan? Make sure to subscribe so you don't miss any future content. And now, let's start with the video. I'm almost sure if you clicked on this video, you've at least heard about Notion. It is an excellent application that a lot of people, including me, use for a wide variety of topics. You can go from simply writing down some of your thoughts or some notes to creating a full-blown database with different views and relations with other databases. You can use this to track your habits, to organize and plan your projects, to manage your expenses, and many other things. I've personally made two databases that I've updated somewhat frequently, one for my published and future YouTube videos, and another one to keep track of the classes I've taken and my performance in each of them. But before we dive into the specifics of the tables, let's start with the basics, and let me explain you the tools you can find in Notion. Right after we create a new page, we can give it a name, add an icon, add a cover from either the pre-selected images, your gallery, an image service called Unsplash, or with the link of any pictures you can find online. When that is done, you can select if you want to start with a blank page, or if you want to select a template to speed up the creation of what you have in mind. As I was telling you before, the simplest task you can accomplish with Notion is to take typed notes. For this, you can change the color of the letter, change the color of the background if you want to create a highlight effect, and you have three heading options for your titles to stand out. There are two ways you can use these headings. You can write your title, click it three times, and choose the heading style you like best, or you can type a forward slash, again select one of the heading styles, and then write your title. When you type that forward slash, you can start seeing all the tools that Notion offers. The first one is for regular typed text. Then we have a page option, and you have to remember, we are always working on pages. So when you're choosing this option, you're creating a link to a new page inside of your current one. Notion also offers checkboxes, bullet, numbered, and toggle lists, which you can nest however you want. After this, you have a tool specifically for quotes, and there's another tool they've called callouts, which makes your writing stand out. There's another page option if you want to include a page you've already created. The first option allowed you to create a new page, but both create a link to the pages inside the one you're working on. Notion allows you to share your workspaces with your friends or anybody you need to work with. You can mention them on your pages and they are going to receive a notification about it. If you want, you can also reference a page in the middle of your paragraphs instead of giving it an entire line. As you're seeing, you can also include dates or reminders, emojis, and even equations. And before we continue, I want to mention that you can move all of the components you have on the page just by dragging and dropping them wherever you want. This also allows you to create multiple columns, which is something I use quite often. Moving on, you can include a link to any web page and you get a little thumbnail with a preview if that's available, of course. And you can also include a link or upload an image, a video, audio, or any file you have in your device. You can resize these embedded files and move them wherever you want so that your page look exactly as you imagined them. You can also include code snippets with support for a lot of different programming languages, which is something I personally appreciate. However, you obviously can't run these programs. I think this may be an alternative way of sharing small pieces of code if you don't like or are not too familiar with GitHub, which is something you can actually also embed. As you're seeing, Notion integrates with a lot of other services, allowing you to have everything you need from a PDF or a tweet to a map or a GitHub repository in just one place. Now, there's one thing that you can also add to your pages, and the easier way that worked for me to understand it is to initially see it as a plain table. In this table, each column can hold text, numbers, dates, the username of anyone that's included in the workspace. You can add a file from your computer or from links of files on the web. You can set it to have checkboxes, URLs, email addresses, phone numbers, and you can create a list per each column and then decide if you want to allow the column to hold one or many of the objects in the list. There's also an advanced section where you can choose to have the time or person that created the row, the time or person that last edited it, or you can have some formulas and relations between your tables, which we're going to discuss later in the video. For now, let me show you the tables I've created that have helped me organize my YouTube videos and my university classes. In this one, I've included the name of the class, its code, the status, which can be either ongoing, completed, or next, the semester, and year I took it, and the grade I got. I recently also added these two, the credit hours and the GPA, and at the end of the table, I have a checkbox that is only checked if the class in the row is related to computer science. Then I have this other table, which is only for my YouTube YouTube videos, which is something I got from another video. I'm actually going to be leaving the videos I saw that helped me understand how to use Notion in the description. In this table, I first have the number of the video, so you can see this is the 17th video. Then I have the title, or at least the main idea of the video. This one is obviously about Notion, and I like to put a reference image at the beginning so that it's easier to identify the videos between the rows. Then I have the playlist or playlists, where I'm going to put the video, the published date, the link of the video, the length in minutes, and the status that can be either next, writing, audio editing, recording, but that's for footage, so technically video recording, then video editing, thumbnail, and I have two types of published, one for regular published videos and the other one for sponsored videos, like this one, because this video is sponsored by Demo Creator. If you haven't heard about Demo Creator before, it is a super easy to use screen recorder and video editor, which is perfect if you're just starting to create your own videos. Demo Creator gives you all the tools in just one software, with a non-complex configuration that lets you customize the essentials to produce tutorials or instruction videos. It also makes the process of recording a specific game simpler because you can choose which program you want to record with the frame rate you like best. As a matter of fact, all the footage from my laptop in this video and the previous one has been recorded using Demo Creator, and this sponsor section has been entirely edited through it. I've tried other screen recording programs, but they make my navigation slower, and with Demo Creator, I was even able to record some gaming using the proper configuration. When it comes to video editing, you have a lot of layers to put your clips on, which you can crop, color label, move, you can change the position, scale, rotation, you can add stickers, titles, transitions, annotations, and you even get a chroma key for your green screen footage. In the description, there's a link for you to check their website and to see their price and options. The best thing is that you can test every feature for free. You just have to purchase it to remove the watermark in the exported file. Thank you very much to everyone that tries it out, and special thanks to Demo Creator for sponsoring today's video. Now that you're familiar with the general idea of tables, there are some customization options that you can apply to them to personalize them even more. The first thing is that you can have different views of your table. These ones are the ones I've created, and if you select add a view, you can select from 5 different types of views. The first one is the regular table we've been using. The second one is called the board. In this case, it grabbed the status column, and for each of the categories inside the list, it created a column where I can freely organize each item and move it from column to column. The first time I saw this type of list was in Trello. I actually saw it from someone else that had a column for the things that had to be done and another one for the things that were already finished. So basically kind of a to-do list. Then there's a calendar view, which takes the first date column and creates events with the name you've given to the row. After this, you can choose the list view, which is a simplified version of the regular table with the names of the rows to the left and some details to the right. Finally, you can choose the gallery view, which takes any image you've added to the rows and displays it as their thumbnail. This makes it way easier to identify something you're looking for, especially when your table is 100 plus rows. Now, as you may have seen, with some views, you can get your entries in a different way you might have thought of. To solve this, you can use the sort feature that lets you choose sorting methods based on the inputs of your rows. You can have multiple sorting rules, and as you could expect, the ones on the top are taken into consideration first for sorting your database, because even though we started seeing it as a table, it is a database with different types of views. And talking about viewing, if you don't want to see any column in any of your views, for example, in this table view of my classes, I don't really need to see the year if I already have it sorted by that column. So I can go to the properties and take that column out. It doesn't affect the sorting in any way, and it also doesn't apply to other views. It is just for this one. The properties are saved specifically for the type of view you choose it. If you want to go even further, you can even take out some entries in your database that you don't really need for a given view. In this case, I'm just interested in seeing the classes I've taken related to computer science. So I can go to filter and add a rule that says that the classes that are going to be shown are the ones where the column called CS has the checkbox checked. And you can add multiple rules. If you have some knowledge in computer science or just truth tables, to be honest, this might look familiar to you. Now, I want to actually talk about the column I used to create this filter, the CS column. It is made from checkboxes, but they are not actually checked manually. It has a formula that makes that whenever I add a class code that starts with CS, it is automatically checked. If you're interested, what I do is slice the content on the code column so that I only get the first two characters, and if these two characters are CS, I need the checkbox to be checked. so it needs to return true, and if not, it needs to return false. I also did something similar with the credit hours column, which comes from the second number after the class code. So basically CS2350 has 3 credit hours and Math1452 has 4 credit hours. In this case, what I did was, again, slice the column code, but this time I needed to get the third to last character. So I get the length of the code, which may vary depending on the class, and take 3 away. Then I get the length again, and this time I take 2 away so that I only get the second number on the class code. And I enclose all of that in a 2 number statement to obtain the final result as a number. I'm not really going to mention every formula, but if you have any questions on how to do something, or if it's even possible, you can leave it in the comments and I'll try to answer it to the best of my understanding. The last things to mention are that you can have calculations at the bottom of your tables, which vary depending on what you have in each column, and each entry in your database can be an entire page on its own. That's how I've included the icon next to the name of each row in this table, and that's also how I've included the thumbnail for the gallery view. And as you can see, I have other things inside. This to-do column is mostly how I organize myself for the creation of the videos. I also have the main idea of the video, which I try to summarize in one sentence, and I have secondary ideas, which are the basis for the divisions of the videos. There are obviously some occasions that I don't have enough time to put these things into writing and I just create the script, but the other times I try my best to have all of these things filled for organization purposes. As you can see, every page of every video in the table is based on these 5 things: the thumbnail, the to-do list, the main idea, the secondary ideas, and the script. I don't manually create this every time I'm starting a new video. If you tab where it says new, you can create a template page that you can use whenever you want to create a new entry in your database that follows any pattern. This one, I have it to be with the highest video number so that it goes to the top of the table. I have it to be with the next status. That's mainly because I try to plan one video ahead, and I have it to be in videos playlist because that's the playlist I have where I store all my videos. And then I have this that says space for thumbnail because that's always the last thing I do, almost at the same time I'm publishing the video. And finally, I have the 4 other things, with the script being a page on its own. I also mark as favorite the script I'm working on at the time to have an easier access to it. And I've also included this thing they've called breadcrumb, which tells you where your page is stored. Additional to this, you can change the style or font of any page, but it doesn't affect any other pages you have. You can also make the font smaller, make it so that the text covers the whole width of the page, or you can also block it so that you cannot edit its content. Hey, this is me editing. I don't know why, but recently every time I make a video review in an app, it receives an update while I'm editing it. The good thing is that hopefully this is the first time you hear about these new features. To start, well, they had some bug fixes and improvements, but the big thing is that they added a new view called timeline. And the thing is that on your databases, when you're adding a date, you can choose if you also want to add an end date. And this new timeline view has everything on your database in ascending order with the simplified view of your table to the left. You can still add sorting methods and filters, but you can now also choose what you want to see on your timeline and on the table to the left. You're always going to see everything on the rows, unless of course you put some filters, but you can choose which of the properties you want to see in each of the sides of the view. And by the way, if you don't like the table to the left, you can also hide it and only focus on your timeline. A timeline that you can choose how to visualize. It can be by hours, days, a week, 2 weeks, a month, a quarter, or a year. They now also allow for more flexibility to your subpages permissions. It says here that before, if you had a master page with 1 or more subpages, each of these always had the same permissions than the master page. But now they've added more flexibility, and it says that you can add subpages which some people can see but others can't, and things like that. Additional to this, they fixed something that a lot of people asked for. And the thing is that even though you can hide some properties on the table, you couldn't hide them when you open the entire page. So it says it helps if you had a lot of entries on your table, but you didn't really need to always see all of them. They also added a limit for how many lines on your databases you want to see on your pages. Mine don't have too much entries, but if you have a table with 1,000 rows, it is a lifesaver to be able to choose how many you want to initially see. And finally, you can now hide any comments or backlinks of specific pages so you can focus on the raw content and avoid any distractions. I personally like to read the update or patch notes from any app, of course, because I always like to try new features. So hopefully this is the first time you hear about these things too. Make sure to leave a like if you did. And now let's get back to the video.
Notion lets you connect your Google Drive, Evernote, Trello, and Asana for you to be able to import things
from there. And the best thing is that you can use Notion on your phone, your laptop, tablet, on the web, wherever you want. There are two plans, and the Personal Pro plan is absolutely free for students and professors. I recently also discovered that you can get some months for free if you do some of these things they've had created for you to earn some credits. As always, don't forget to subscribe to support the channel. I had initially thought to make this video at the beginning of fall, so it was going to be a video planning my semester using Notion, but it kept being pushed by other video ideas, so let me know if I should do it for next year's spring. But for now, this has been a regular teenager. Take care. Peace.